thank you for staying here so late. So I actually made a mistake. I misread the program, so I thought that the talk would have, should have been 30 minutes, but I will try to be as fast as I can, and I will cut some slides that are anyway boring. So I'm actually really happy to be, first of all, invited, and secondly, to be coupled with the last presentation, because somehow I'm trying to reimagine the meaning of postmodern in architecture by using actually the organicism as an example. So yeah, let's give it a try. And I'm trying to do so because actually I think that to this we are discussing about postmodern, we are interested in about postmodernism because today it's basically and quite simply fashionable again. Otherwise we wouldn't care much. The only problem is that when we have all of this stuff that is defined as neo-pomo, this is clearly a definition that doesn't work, that doesn't really mean anything. So that my attempt would be, if we want to use postmodern, that is something that I wouldn't suggest as a word, at least I think we should somehow rewrite it or reinventing it. So actually, the question would be, what is postmodernism and how to address postmodernism from today's point of view, from the needs of today? So basically, in architecture, we all know it. When we talk about postmodernism, we think about this kind of architecture that is using literal references to history in a kind of an ironic way. But then, of course, when you discuss about this topic, it comes another person that maybe says, oh, wait, no, postmodern is something much more complicated. There are work of artists and musicians like Cindy Sherman or Bob Wilson or Frank Zappa who are defined as postmodern. So what is postmodernism? And then there are the historians who say, wait, no, postmodernism actually might find some of its roots already in the avant-garde, in the work of people like Kafka or Duchamp, or even in the 18th century with Jean-Jacques Lecoq, who was doing this kind of collage of parts and symbolic elements. And of course, in architecture, there is the elephant in the room, I think, that is postmodern philosophy, because of course, there have been exchanges between architecture and philosophy. So people like the theorists would have, of course, referred to it. And here there is this sort of a, I would say, really postmodern contradiction of architects using postmodern thinking or, in order to overcome postmodernism as a style. So this kind of a, I don't know, loop of thinking of people like Greg Ling and Peter Eisenman who are referring to Deleuze and Derrida and so on and so forth. Yeah, I think we can skip it. The thing is that actually, to me, it's quite interesting though to dig in this contradiction in the sense that the postmodern philosophy, of course, is something really, really different from what is discussed in architecture. So for instance, Lyotard in The Postmodern Condition, who I think it's the text that somehow puts the foundation of postmodern thinking with the works of others, is actually discussing the role of computerization and informatization of culture and how the computer is changing, let's say, our way of thinking about knowledge and power and so on and so forth. And I think he says things that are quite topical today, like ideas about what can be referred as the internet today, about tools of structuring power or maybe allowing new forms of hacking the power, the structures of power. So I think it's kind of interesting now from today's point of view to dig in the postmodern from this different angle in architecture. And Lyotard, to me, I think it's quite interesting because he was invited a few times to discuss about architecture. So for instance, in 1985, Vittorio Cregotti, in this issue of Casabella, invited Lyotard to discuss postmodern architecture. And he writes this paper that is Repetizione, Complexità, Anamnesi, meaning repetition, complexity, and anamnesis, in which is tragically critical about postmodern architecture. So what he's saying is more or less that postmodern architecture, to him, being postmodern, after the modern, is condemned to generate a series of tiny alterations. And he focuses on the concept of tiny alterations. So he's condemned not to produce anything new and different, and it does so, according to him, ironically, cynically, and stupidly. So that's, again, referring to before. But of course, I mean, of course, Lyotard was kind of critical about it because somehow, as a philosopher, refers to the avant-garde in terms of aesthetic, yet is also providing some clues about what it could be the postmodern according to him. So first of all, he says that postmodern is not about copying the classical in modern architecture, but it's rather an expression of thought in arts, literature, philosophy, and politics. And then he uses the word Durcharbeiten, which is a kind referring to Sigmund Freud, the idea of postmodernity as a kind of an anamnesis of modernity, so a kind of a continuous re-elaborating and re-elaboration of the problems of modernity through the different media of today's condition, which I think it might be interesting, and I will try to prove it. And he says, as I was saying, that we should rather than instead of using the prefix postmodern that, well, yeah, contradictorily he uses always, we should use the prefix ana, which is analysis, anamnesis, anagony, and elaborating modernity. Now, it's interesting because this paper is published in the same year in which he was curating this exhibition at the Centre Pompidou in Paris, which is Les Immatériaux. It's 1985. And here he's also showing some works by architects next to different stuff. So for instance, he's showing, this is the catalog, new plastics, new materials as forms of art, which again, if we think about what many architects are discussing today, I think are things that are quite topical, and it's just 1985. Well, of course, the first attempts of producing art pieces with the computer, which probably are quite failed, but anyway, it was an attempt. The idea of anthropization of the land, as somehow this, today we would say Anthropocene and all of these awkward slogans. Or, in terms of architecture, is exposing the work of the young Zadid with Ren Kolas, like this table. Or, of course, Peter Eisenman, who is everywhere. But he's working on this direction of, let's say, an abstract language in terms as a postmodern way of thinking about architecture. So much so that at first I was thinking that maybe Lyotard was actually discussing the idea of what today we call as deconstructivism. So this idea of referring to modernity in order to produce this quotation and these ironic statements. Yet, he's a French philosopher, nothing is easy with them. And this is what he says. In another paper, he says that postmodern architects are stupid, not just because they copy classical architecture, but also because rewriting modernity, that is his idea of postmodernity, has nothing to do with the use of parodies or quotation of modern or modernist works. So the question is, what does he want? He is not, neither that one nor the other, so the question would be, what does Lyotard want? In this same paper, of course, he said, actually, again, gives some clues, which is that, as he writes, and I read, postmodernity is not a new age, but the rewriting of some of the features claimed by modernity. And first of all, modernity's claim to ground its legitimacy on the project of liberating humanity as a whole through science and technology. So somehow, he's saying that, basically, postmodernity should be a critical stance against determinism or, let's say, the use of technology in an easy-minded way. Still, the question remains, if, according to Lyotard, is neither the reference to classical architecture nor the reference to modern architecture, what can this sort of postmodern can be, or at least, how can we define this sort of postmodern? Because somehow Lyotard contradicts himself by exposing the work of the deconstructivist architects. So, what can we do out of this? What we know is that, according to him, postmodernity is a sort of rewriting of modernity, aka anamnesis, and a critique of idea of technological determinism. So maybe the first hypothesis could be that we can think about the work of the radical architects as a sort of a critical postmodernity, in this case are the Italians one, because somehow they were criticizing the idea of technological determinism, or rather taking to its maximum extreme in order to delete it. Yet, we also know that the Italian, particularly radicals, they were trying to, rather than rewrite modernity, to kill modernity, in the sense that they were just focusing on processes and somehow trying to get rid of the same idea of the very idea of composition. Yet, I think that somehow we can use this idea of Lyotard as a form of defining postmodern architecture in the Austrian, cultural environment of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, particularly in the radical period, maybe. Yes, somehow they were less nihilistic than the Italians, they were more ironic, they were more, positive, yet really being critical and rewriting this idea of modernity, and I would say even more so in the so-called Die Grazer Schule in the city of Graz, that is this smaller city in Austria, which has a sort of a school of a strange group of architects that was defined in the 80s through this exhibition and other papers, in 1981, and as Die Neue Grazer Schule. Now, this group of architects actually was studying there in Graz and working as young architects. And as we see, they are influenced by the radicals and the cultural discussions of the time. So for instance, here we see how they were trying to copy and refer to the work of course, of Archigram and all the utopian, utopian architects of London. Yet, it's quite hard to define this kind of stuff postmodern because, as we know, the most famous architects in this group, who would be Günther Domenig, were working on this really organicist way of thinking about architecture. There is not a postmodern idea, yet I think that it's not that easy in the sense that, of course, they also write against the postmodern, so they say, organicism is the end of the postmodern, not even the end, the misery of the postmodern. Yet, there are these elements, I would say that there are postmodern elements that can help us today. So for instance, this is a bank in Vienna, designed and built by Günther Domenig, which is already quite interesting to know that an architect can convince a bank manager to build such a thing. But what we see is this kind of obsession of personal aspects in his work, which I would define, of course, it would work really fine, the idea of anamnesis, referring to Lyotard, but it's quite more, I think, in the sense that, for instance, this is his own house. So he builds this house where he lives, he starts to build it in 1983, and he finished just before dying, lucky him. And he writes these things about the house. That is, of course, it's my own house. It's the private dimension of architecture. He defines the idea of doing architecture, of designing as a private thing. It is the earth and the sky, darkness and light, power and down. It is my world, it is the world. And it is the metamorphosis of the characteristic landscape of Carinthia. Of course, he's playing somehow with this metaphor in reference to the Alps and so on and so forth. Yet, it's even more than that, there is, for instance, this piece designed by Domenig for his own house that is a lamp, which he describes as a sort of a, simply as an experiment in using joints between pieces of metal. Yet, of course, it's also a bird. And the name of the, sculpture lamp is Nix Nut Nix. That is a way of playing with words, which means basically nothing. It's just nothing, just something I did, which is then set in his own house. So we see again, I think this is interesting because we see a way of referencing to history, to elements that are not disciplinary in a more absurd way, more or less, I think, as Frank Gehry maybe was doing. And we see a similar strategy and sort of operations in all of these architects. So this is, for instance, Manfred Kovacs, who is working on these wood houses that are quite simple. Yet we see this attempt of referring to the classical and typical architecture from Austria and from the Alps, and I imagine also in Hungary there are similar things, by somehow referring to that kind of language, to the use of material, but still trying also to estrange some of the elements of this tradition, which I think it's this form of non-literality today might be actually quite interesting, and it would, I think, fit with what Lyotard was criticizing about the way architects were using quotations at the time. And of course, others like Konrad Frey, who would work on the Alpine houses, doing this the same kind of operation, maybe in a more expressive way. Yeah. Or others, like this group that is Szyszkowitz Kowalski, I'm really sorry for the pronunciation, who were working again, as all the others, with this really expressive language, almost expressionist. Yet, if we, I think it's a project for a schloss, for a castle, for the extension of a castle. And if we look at the plan more carefully, I think, I hope you can see it, we see some elements that somehow refer to the typical Baroque and late Baroque architecture that is from Bavaria and Austria, which was something very typical for their culture, yet applied, again, through means of abstraction in this modern and more organicist language, which I think it's quite interesting in their work. Not all of their work is really interesting in the sense that then they become really commercial, but in this plan, I think we see glimpses of this different way of quoting history, which I think could be interesting today. Or this project, which, of course, if we look at it, we see again this use of organic language and so on and so forth. Yet, this project is also a Kunstzentrum for the palace of the government of the region of Vorarlberg in Austria. And if one knows the geography of Austria, we see that the shape of the region of Vorarlberg is this one. So what it's doing is this kind of a, let's say, abstraction. Here is maybe a bit stupid and naive, using of the plan of the region when it's working in order to produce his project. Or even more, let's say, maybe ironically, Konrad Frey, who in the 60s, again influenced by the radical architects of London, he's applying these radical ideas to the local aspects of Austria, which are cows, and he's doing the co-icle, so the cow which becomes a car thanks to the new technologies, which is, well, anyway, I thought it was funny. And then other people, I mean, this group of architects is really sometimes weird. This is not particularly interesting. Manfred von Plotteg, who makes this kind of Austrian futon construction. And he does it simply quite like this. He takes a typically Austrian thing in a bourgeois house of an Austrian family, and he does this. But yet, of course, we can say that if we want to intellectualize it, because we like to do it, we can refer to Bruno Munari, Bruce MacLean, and other people who were doing this kind of stuff better and earlier, but anyway. Yet, Plotteg, I think it's quite interesting in the sense of what Lyotard was saying in terms of discussing the technological determinism, because he was one of the architects who in the 80s was already working with digital media. He was writing software, so I think he's now teaching at the TU in Vienna. And he was doing this kind of stuff. So he was writing softwares in order to make these mashups, this morphing between cows and houses, typical houses from Austria and cows, and doing this kind of results. You see, it's, of course, it's quite simple, but I think it's somehow, I think it can be defined as a sort of an avant-garde postmodern gesture. But as it is this one, in this software that he developed again in the same period, this is, I think, more interesting because he extracted from this software that, well, here it's not really readable, some general geometric and rules and some laws, and it applied them in order to make this building, which is probably not the best building, but I think that the method is interesting because it's a social house building, social housing building in Graz, done with these already computational manners that I think I'm, well, just, yeah, if Patrick Schumacher was here, I would just try to show it. But I think, anyway, that proves how actually there is a possibility in postmodernism if we get rid of the usual definition that is given as the use of columns and so on and so forth and colors and blah, a possibility of thinking about the idea of this sort of hacking or, let's say, critical stance against this technological determinism that today I find it particularly, let's say, invading our culture, which I think through these architects can be reassumed through these main points, which can be many more or less, whatever, which is the idea of referencing to history and our tradition as a non-literal aspect, because of course this is also a political issue today, mixing locals with photorealistic element, the idea of self-expression, which is often denied by many postmodernist thinkers, particularly in architecture, so they just go run around university saying the author is dead because they've read the title of some book by some French thinkers, but there is nothing really more than that. So why not the idea of self-expressing in the project as a sort of critique, hacking the cliches of using technology, and basically, to cut it short, being what I think can be called against the method, and of course here I use the trick, because against the method, actually, was a slogan, a title, used in a book by Paul Karl Feuerabend, who was an Austrian philosopher. I don't know if these guys have read it. Some say yes, some say no. They don't talk about it, nonetheless. But anyway, but he writes, I think, things that resonate with both with what Lyotard was saying and what these architects were doing. So for instance, he would write things like, without a constant misuse of language, there cannot be any discovery. Or science is essentially an anarchic enterprise, which means that theoretical anarchism, according to him, is more humanitarian and more likely to encourage progress than the idea of law and order alternatives. That is surely what these architects were doing, not following the laws of language and styles. And I think what Lyotard was aiming for. And at the same time that the scientists in this case, we can say architects, I think, play the game of reason in order to undercut the authority of reason, which is, I think, quite almost the same thing that is saying Lyotard about the postmodern, using the word modern and anamnesis. So I think that this group of architects and this sort of, let's say, if we try to open up the definition of the postmodern also in our discipline, we find this sort of a policy that can be defined as anarchist and libertarian, which is also interesting, I think, but I haven't studied really much until now, because there are a group of, there are some studies about the work of Lyotard and the French philosopher and the post-structuralist thinking that is defined today as post-anarchism. So people have found some connections between the two. And in conclusion, I would just like to read this one. I paraphrase this quotation, which is about post-anarchism, because I think it apply quite well, at least. This is what I would like we should start to do with postmodernism. That is, it is because postmodernism has come to the light in this unprecedented way, as the horizon of politics today, we can say architecture, that we must rethink some of its classical foundations in ways that are at the same time faithful to its basic ethos of liberty, equality, anti-authoritarianism, sorry, and solidarity. So my argument has been that postmodernism has something new to teach itself. Postmodernism is animated by a living, breathing spirit of anarchy that disturbs its static foundation and fixed identities. And I think that quite simply is what we should address today in architecture. That's all.